What does flight mean to you? Immediately, we think of birds, winged beings, high above. But to think of ourselves flying, we think of an airplane. Two, tail, wings. Everyone knows that's how you fly. That's what we're used to, following the same basic model that Wright brothers used.
After a century of innovation, we're still limiting ourselves to the Wright's assumptions about manned flight.
As said by Sir Ken Robinson,
if you're not prepared to be wrong, you will never come up with anything original.
As engineers, we take that to heart. We believe it's time to push the boundaries of aviation. We believe in making the impossible possible and are captivated by the idea of enabling the future to exist today. Since 1946, the Dryden Flight Research Center has been the premier facility for atmospheric flight testing. For over 60 years, the most advanced aircraft of the day have flown here. So much expertise, knowledge, innovation. Surely the basics of flight are well understood. But what if we miss something? In the late 1800s, people were thinking about heavier-than-air flight. Balloons weren't cutting it. They understood the need for a force pushing you up that would overcome gravity pulling you down. See, when an airplane is in steady level flight, it experiences four major forces: lift, weight, thrust, and drag. Weight constantly tries to pull the airplane down, and the airplane must produce lift to stay in the air. Thrust provides enough force to overcome drag. Now, drag is more complex. There are three main types of drag: viscous, pressure, and induced drag, all acting to slow the airplane from flying forward. Aircraft designers are most concerned with induced drag, a byproduct of lift. Lift is generated by producing high pressure underneath the wing and a low pressure above. But pressure acts in all directions, not just up or down. Thus, while the plane is in flight, air will leak from beneath the wing and curl around the tip. This spins the air as it moves around the wing. This is called a wingtip vortex, and it looks like a small tornado coming off the end of the wing. This isn't good. Making these takes a lot of waste energy, and if you think of the air as water, it's like making big splashes in a pool. Now, however you design your wing, to get more lift, you need a bigger difference in pressure. The more lift produced, the more induced drag there will be, because more air will leak and curl around the wingtips. In 1925, Ludwig Prandtl derived the first way to minimize drag. His solution was the elliptical span load. So a wing doesn't produce all of its lift in one place. Rather, it produces a little bit of lift everywhere. And Prandtl came up with how much lift should be produced at a particular location along the wing. And visually, his solution was a quarter of an ellipse, where the most lift was at the root of the wing and tapered to zero at the wingtips. More than 85 years later, this is still the solution we use when designing aircraft. When the Wright brothers first flew their 1901 glider, they could not get the airplane to turn. Every time they rolled their aircraft in one direction, it would turn in the opposite direction and crash. As they rolled the airplane, one wing generated more lift, but also more induced drag, forcing the nose to turn, or yaw, in the opposite direction. We call this adverse yaw. To solve this, the Wrights put a rudder on their airplane, which would angle more drag on the tail that would directly oppose the induced drag on the wings, forcing their airplane to yaw the correct way. Controlled flight was solved.
Or was it? After publishing his paper in 1925, Prandtl continued thinking about minimizing drag. He knew about adverse yaw and how the Wrights accounted for it, but to overcome drag with drag?
He thought back to the inspiration for flight. He wondered why he'd never seen a bird with a rudder. How did they do it?
The Aeronautics Academies of 2012 and 2013 at NASA Dryden wondered the very same thing.
In 1932, Prandtl published another paper on induced drag. By considering the strength of a wing, rather than just the wingspan, he derived a new bell-shaped lift distribution that would produce 11% less induced drag. At the same time, two teenagers, Walter and Rymar Horton, began designing all-wing gliders, no tail at all. To get Prandtl's bell-shaped lift distribution, they added twists to their wing design.
They discovered as they turned their glider, the nose followed the roll of the vehicle. They didn't need a rudder.
To explain their solution, I have to explain the work of Dick Whitcomb and his devices known as winglets. You've all seen them, little tips that point up on Southwest jetliners. These small vertical sections are actually little wings, just pointing up. They're also sticking straight into the vortices we were talking about before. They're making lift, same as the main wing, Only now, the force of the lift is pointing, or pushing, as you can imagine, inward and a little bit forward. This means we're actually getting a little bit of extra push forward. Normally, it's only our engines that push us forward. This works because the vortices start at the tip and curl into our winglet. But if you folded them out horizontally and kept the start of the vortex in the same place, they would still work. You would have flat winglets. And Prandtl had figured this out, only accidentally. The bell-shaped distribution of lift he derived caused inboard vortices, and the Hortons were seeing this. But wait, you still have to account for adverse yaw. The Horton aircraft will increase induced drag as it rolls and yaw the wrong way. Wrong. The Horton wing actually uses adverse yaw to its advantage. When it rolls, the lift on one wing is increased, and yes, so does the induced drag. Bigger vortices, remember? But now, those vortices are hitting our flat winglet, and stronger vortices give the winglet more push forward. The new thrust we're getting overcomes any induced drag, and we yaw the correct way. The past two Aeronautics Academies at NASA Dryden have built a prototype, dubbed the Primary Research Aerodynamic Design to Lower Drag, or the Prandtl D for short. No data was initially collected until we were able to instrument the vehicle and record turning rates and accelerations.
What we found was better than we could have ever possibly hoped for.
Roll and yaw occurred in the same direction, and by definition, we were seeing proverse yaw. We demonstrated the fundamental principle in a design that claims a 60% increase in aircraft efficiency. We had found a viable aircraft for the future. We'd all come from different schools and backgrounds, brought together here by the love of freedom obtained by flight, along with speed, power, new frontiers, and knowledge. NASA Dryden, through our work on the Prandtl project, gave us the ideal environment to combine both the tangible elements of aircraft flight testing with theory learned at school. We weren't just witnessing a breakthrough in aerodynamics. We were contributing to it. We had challenged assumptions, conventions, and paradigms. This was our first step. We are the NASA Aeronautics Academy of 2013.